Welcome, Martin.
Welcome.
And what a magnificent job of compressing 8 volumes into such a readable life of Churchill.
Thank you very much indeed.
And what a fascinating man who is the product of an American mother, Jenny Jerome, and his father, who is Sir Randolph Churchill. That's not the quite the correct title
for him. He was
Lord Randolph Churchill.
Even grander.
Yeah. And he is their firstborn, who is, in a sense, the neglected child. The mother who doesn't show up at boarding school when he's age 7, and the father who's too busy to see him when he is running for office.
Right. You remember there's the occasion I tell in the book when son is recovering from a desperate bout of pneumonia and reads in the paper that father has been down to the town, given a speech, and returned to London without seeing his son.
I did, and I thought it's like Charles Dickens with money. But that is a theme that in a way runs through his life, when his devotion to Clementine, his devotion to his daughters, and the fact his secretaries. And you said of all the people who have written about Churchill, you got the perspective of the women who had worked for him.
Yes, they saw him warts and all, and if you like, with clothes and without clothes. They saw the real man, his terrible tantrums and furies, and at the same time, his incredible warmth and affection. So they, of course, I wasn't having their recollections with hindsight, but the letters they wrote at the time, the diaries they wrote at the time, how they really saw him from day to day.
Was he a hero to them?
Oh, they loved him dearly, yeah, because he treated them as human beings. And when he saw they were distressed, either by his behavior or by something that had happened to them privately, he went out of his way to be kind and generous. And he was fun.
You know, there are catalysts in this man's life that are amazing, such as when he fights in the Boer War, is captured, and his escape.
Yes, he was, first of all, he had enormous luck. And one of the things I tried to show in the book was that, you know, all of us have a little luck in life. But he somehow, almost every year, a narrow escape from death, a narrow escape from dying for some, you know, reason. I mean, bullets coming next to where he's sitting. And the escape from the Boers was his political luck, because up till then he was a young unknown. But at a time when the war was going badly for Britain, suddenly an escape, a success, a marvelous story. Yeah. And as he was a young journalist, he was able, of course, to tell the story himself over the wires and get it worldwide.
Yeah. Well, you have it here, you know, how he wrote it, and it was sort of like brief, like almost telegrams. Captured, escaped, run along railroad, right. Follow the line, escape under the tunnels, and then finally the rescue.
Right, and of course the people in England thought, what a marvelous relief from all the gloom of the war news, and so he went back and he was elected to Parliament. And there he was, his career was made, and he had 60 years in the British Parliament.
But they weren't all easy years, because there is a point where he is, what one could say, almost not quite sent to Coventry by his party, but he's out of favor. And Chamberlain is in, and there are a few Chamberlains at that point.
Yes. In fact, his life was dogged by these Chamberlains. Even, you know, in the First World War, Asquith turning his back on him, the British Prime Minister, for whom he had done so much, spewing him out because it was politically convenient to get rid of Winston. And then, as you say, Neville Chamberlain simply not wanting him in, and intriguing, as I show in the book, really for the first time, intriguing behind Churchill's back to get him thrown out of Parliament. You know, to get the one independent voice, the one warning voice, not even able to speak.
Martin, you show a Churchill that most people do not know about also, the man of a social conscience, and many of his programs were not what one expects from the Tory party.
Not at all. And you know, this was one of the thrills of doing the research, to see that this man, from his early 20s till his late 70s, believed that the job of people like himself, forceful people, strong people at the center, their job was to be concerned with those who were unable to look after themselves, the poor, the impoverished, the unemployed. And this was such a consistent theme in his life. And I was pleased to be able to find his own legislation, the things he had put on the statute book to make the lives of ordinary people better.
Let's elucidate a little bit on that as far as education, health plans, job opportunities for all.
The three main things.
Yeah.
He came in such a class-ridden society in Britain. Some of it still survives to this day. And he said education should be open for everybody, not just for the wealthy, not just for the open upper classes. And so in 1942, he appointed a young radical, R.A. Butler, and said to him, devise an education program where education will be open to all. And in that same year, he said to the doctors, why don't you, the doctors, accept a national health insurance plan? I will give it my political backing, but of course the doctors rejected it. They're always behindhand at these things. And finally, he believed that every person working in an enterprise, and he first expressed this in 1895, should have a share in the profits. In other words, your cameraman here should have a share in your profits,
and my
secretary should have a share in my profits.
Yeah.
And his idea was, you know, if somebody does well, it's only because of the people who are working on the factory floor.
Yeah.
But if they do badly, then the people working would have an added incentive to make it work well, because they'd know they would get the profits in the end. Now, he proposed that in the 1890s, and our new British Prime Minister, John Major, is interested in doing it in the 1990s.
And it was that mental attitude about people that he was able to pull together in Britain's darkest hour.
Yes, because he believed that the individual had these rights. But at the same time, how could the individual exercise the rights if tyrannies and threats were omnipresent? And the British people, you know, they'd led a fairly luxurious life, if you like. They'd gone their own way. They'd allowed Hitler to dominate the scene. But he said to them, look, unless you're prepared to stand up to Hitler, there is no way that anything you aspire to can be achieved. And so they rallied to him. No one but he saw victory. They said, how can we avoid defeat? He said, I'm not offering you avoiding defeat. I'm offering you victory. And this was, in a way, the excitement that he created.
Martin, we'll take a short pause. When we come back, we'll talk about bundles for Britain from the United States, the loan, the Harry Hopkins, FDR, and finally Czechoslovakia and Poland. We'll be back with our guest, Martin Gilbert.